In this video, we'll implement a scripted REST API. A scripted REST API enables us to go beyond the built-in APIs on the platform to accept custom inputs, do custom processing, and return custom payloads, which can be very powerful when dealing with integrations. Also, in the previous video, check out the great information on designing a scripted REST API. Okay, real quick. Our scripted REST API is going to accept a course name and return an object representing some of the details of the course record and all related student records. We'll follow this plan of first creating the API, creating the resource, then we'll test with the REST API Explorer, test with an external command, and turn on versioning. We'll start by typing scripted REST in the navigation filter on the left. Here we'll find the scripted REST APIs under System Web Services, Scripted Web Service. From Studio, we can start by clicking Create Application File, then either search for scripted REST API or find it under Inbound Integrations. Either way is fine. They accomplish the same thing. All right, step one. Let's give our API a name. The system automatically creates an API ID, which becomes part of the endpoint. We'll leave the protection policy alone for now. If we were a partner interested in protecting our intellectual property, we may want to look into this more. Step two, use the form menu to save. There are more details on this form than we have time to go into in this quick video, so please check the documentation to learn more about any of them. Next, we'll go to the resources related list and click New. Each API can have one or more resources. This is particularly handy when we want to group a number of endpoints for different functions on our application. For example, our API may be called Training, and our first resource will get a course and related students. Later, we can add more resources to perhaps create a course, or add a student to or remove a student from a course, and so on. We'll give our resource a name. And very importantly, we'll verify the HTTP method. It defaults to GET, which is correct in this case, but it's very easy to overlook this and run into problems later. The relative path is also part of the endpoint. If we only have one resource, we can leave it as slash. But experience has shown that this is beneficial to put a value here. We'll use one similar to the resource name. Now we get to the scripted part of our scripted REST API. We're automatically provided a template to work with that offers us two built-in objects, request and response. The request object represents the input information sent to our system by the remote system or app. Response is the output information we're returning. We'll start the script by defining a default template object for a response. This makes it easy to populate, return values, and diagnose issues. And we want to make sure we avoid JavaScript keywords and reserved object names like response, current, and event, as this could cause issues. We'll also set a default response status code variable with a value of 404. If our course lookup fails, we'll return that. It's safer to assume a failure status in most cases. Now, remember when we talked about input parameters in the previous video and decided that the query parameters are best design decision? This is where we'll access it. Code completion helps us access the various request objects and properties quickly. It only takes a few seconds to get that query parameter using dot, arrow, and tab keys, then typing our parameter name. Next, we'll do a glide record lookup to get the course record by name and fill in the course details. If we look closely, we can see that we're using get value for most of the properties. This ensures we get the value and not an object. We're also using parse int because getValue returns a string by default. If our API provides a number instead of a string, this is one less thing that the consumer of our API has to be concerned about. And finally, as noted in our design document, reference and choice fields are being represented as an object to provide the display value for human consumption and the value that has the information for the system. For example, it may be used for a subsequent request to get details about the course offering and a SysID is required as a query parameter. The second part of our answer object is the list of students. We'll use this code snippet to get the appropriate related records from our attendee table and build each object, then push it into an array. Notice how we're using getRefRecord here. The attendee record has an employee field, which is a reference to SysUser. So we need to get that record for the student details. The final step is to return our response body and status. When the script is complete, we'll check the security settings. In this case, we'll require authentication, meaning the remote system or app needs credentials to access our API. The account also requires the SNC internal role, and we've additionally added the REST API ACL. We'll save the resource, and we can test it using the REST API Explorer using this link under related links. In the REST API Explorer, we'll add our query parameter, provide the name and value we wish to test, and click Send. And there's our response payload. We can also use an invalid course name to verify we get the 404 status and empty results in the response body. Let's click this link in the REST API Explorer to get a curl command and test our API on the command line. We'll copy the snippet and paste it to our command line. A quick adjustment to the username and password and hit enter. And there's our response body. Now we've got high confidence that it'll work when our LMS makes a similar request. Before we hand out the endpoint to anyone, this is a good time to consider versioning. Remember, versioning allows us to change the inputs, behavior, and outputs of the API without impacting existing systems or apps. To enable versioning, we go back to the scripted REST API and use the related link Enable Versioning. The system asks if we want V1 to be the default, which is perfect for the first release, so we'll click OK. On the resource record, we can see an API version field, and the resource path has been updated to include V1. If someone were to use the default resource path, they would get V1 by default. But if we were to change this and update it to V2, their integration may not behave as expected. So when using versioning, always try to give out the resource path with the specific version they need. That takes care of creating a scripted REST API. Join me in the next video to look at how we can use ACLs to secure our scripted REST API.